I'm Al Crawford, Chairman, CEO of Bankers Healthcare Group, and started the company as a co-founder about approximately 20 years ago.
Well, thanks so much for making time to join us on the Avi podcast today. Before we spend time talking about your current role in Bankers Health Group, give us a thumbnail version of your career to date.
Sure, and thank you, John, for having me here today. I certainly appreciate it, and look forward to spending some time with you here. So, yeah. You know, my background has pretty much been in the in kind of the poor man's securitization and the origination side. I started my career years ago. I came out of Gettysburg College and wanted to go from I live in a rural community in upstate New York and wanted to go to the big city. So I basically left Syracuse and went down to the big city and couldn't afford the city. So I moved my grandparents out on Long Island. And this was before cell phones and computers. And so I took the Long Island Railroad in from St. James, Long Island, 3 hours to Manhattan, and then the subway 20 minutes down to the New York Stock Exchange. And I started my career out as a clerk in the New York Stock Exchange. And I can still remember it cost $165 to take that train in. And I took it out every night. It's 3 hours and 20 minutes back. So I spent the first year in business out of college commuting 7 hours approximately a day. And it was probably the biggest impetus for my career that I could have had, because back then you didn't have cells, you didn't have social media, you didn't have anything else. So you're right. So on the way in, I read the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Barron's, London Times, you name it. If it was a financial publication, I read it going in. Going home, I was so fried, I just read a pleasure book, you know, going back. And did this for probably about a year and a half. And there's no doubt about it, it helped jumpstart my career, because anything to know about finance, I really learned it just through reading the trade publications. And I've always been a big reader, so it was a great way to kill time and learn as you had that horrific commute that at 3 a.m. in the morning you could do in 42 minutes. But rush hour, that wasn't the case. And I went from there and I jumped back up and joined a family investment banking firm and basically started selling banks, different types of bond portfolio securitizations. Went from that into kind of my own little poor man's securitization business, helping banks in certain areas, mainly rural Western states, get loan assets that are a little bit diversified from, let's say, their ag that they had out there, their heavy ag, and bring them a portfolio of automobiles or mortgages from maybe an East Coast bank or West Coast bank. And did that for a number of years. And then about 20 years ago, ran into my two partners, and I was big on the securitization side. I had a big bank group. They were big on the origination side. They got paid a broker's fee to do that. I got paid a broker's fee to do the other side. We said, hey, if we do away with the broker's fees, the companies we originate for and the companies I get money for do well, maybe we'll do okay, you know, not having to pay those fees and just to originate and basically package the business ourselves. And there was three of us. Today, there's 1,100 people at BHG, and the company's grown a lot. But back 20 years ago, it was put your head down, start about 7 a.m., finished up at about 9 that night, if you were lucky, the three of us. And we loved it. So it was kind of a passion for all three of us. And survival is an interesting motivator. You know, when you have three kids, a wife, a house, car payments, and this is all you have, you work, you know, you get after it. So my two partners were in a similar situation. They were married, kids, and this is all we had. And so we loved it and we went at it passionately too.
Wow, what a story. And appreciate the background on, you know, what you've done before. And also definitely you beat me to the punch about the story behind, you know, how you kind of came about, you know, building BHD, the story behind that definitely resonates on so many levels. I'm sure we can talk about the rest of the episode about this, because as a fellow startup founder, entrepreneur, I know exactly how that goes. You know, I've started many companies. I successfully failed most of them. So it's been an interesting journey. So definitely a lot of examples in terms of the survival, what you've talked about. I think that's a very interesting concept. So fast forward 20 years, like it's a large enterprise with thousands of employees. Tell me a little bit about some of the strategies and maybe practical recommendations when it comes to building and fostering that culture of innovation, because I'm pretty sure you guys had to pivot a lot based on where you had originally started, where you at right now. Curious to get your take on that.
Sure. And you know, and I want to just make one comment too. I had failures. I had a number of failures during that period of going to Wall Street where I failed as a trader. I wanted to be a trader. I wanted to be a pit trader. I was in the New York futures pit as a clerk. And then I got a chance to trade and I wasn't good at it, you know, and you can come up with a lot of excuses. It's this person's fault. They won't hit me. I'm not part of the fraternity. But at the end of the day, I wasn't good at it because there was great traders. And this was back in the day before everything was digital and electronic. You had the pits and, you know, you look around the pits, there's guys making millions and millions of dollars. So you got to look in a mirror, I think, too, and say, hey, you weren't good at it, you know, and that's why you weren't successful. It wasn't because this, and this. And then there was other businesses that you know, I were in trials and tribulations, like, wow, I never thought this could happen. And I was making X amount, and I got a family, and now I'm making $35,000 a year, and I was making $500,000 the year before. And what happened here? So it wasn't this. And I don't think life is this. I think life is up, down. If you don't expect stuff to come at you, I've learned this, I'm 59, you're not a realist. Stuff's gonna happen. Nobody expected COVID to come, nobody. And it came and it changed things. And now it's kind of crazy, but we've kind of changed back. You know, if you were a year ago, we're all gonna die. Everything's going to hell in a handbasket. There is no solution, and it's going to be just horrible. And it was horrific. You know, for those who lost loved ones, it was horrific. But it didn't wipe out mankind as we know it. You know, human beings are resilient, and it's crazy. But a year later, we're kind of back. It's changed again. You know, now you got to stay with the change. So I hear you, John, too. You know, it's not... I didn't learn from where I was successful, to be really honest. I learned from where I failed. And I'm sitting there making 35 saying, what went wrong here? Why did I spend all this money when I had money? I was younger. And so I think you learn a lot about yourself, and you learn a lot that, hey, next time I'm going to do it a little bit differently. And next time, you know, give me another shot, I'll do it a little bit differently. I never really thought that I couldn't do things again. I never really like panicked, like, oh my God, I'm going to just be destitute. It was more like, what am I going to do? How am I going to get going again? And what do I really want to do to get going again and making those decisions? So meeting Bobby and Eric, the three of us, it was pretty much, you know, I can do this much, you can do this much, and you can do this much. And we each had our independent roles. And when we were totally matched, John, it was like, okay, I need another person to help me talk to banks and sell banks. I'm gonna bring somebody on to help me because I can't handle all the banks, the volume's growing, so you add a person. And to be brutally honest, our initial ads were horrible. They were a lot of family, a lot of friends. Hey, you're a warm body, I know you, you wanna work for me, we got a great thing going, come work for me. But you're not qualified at all. I didn't even look to see if you were qualified. So we grew, and we grew with family and friends. And I'm not saying that that's all wrong, but if the family or the friend is qualified, it's okay. And it's even tough if you've got to let them go or if there's an issue down the road because they're their family or your friend, so it's horrible. But if it works out, it's really fun because it's a friend, it's a family member. And we had people that we hired then that did last with us. But we also had to recalibrate over the years and say, you know, you really don't know credit, and you're a credit officer because we put you in that seat. We've got to make a change here. So we grew, and it was kind of funny. It was ebbs and flows. We never really, because we were so conservative at heart in terms of cash, we never really grew that much until we just couldn't handle it ourselves. Yeah. I'm working till 9 o'clock at night. I'm exhausted. I'm exhausting my team. We need to add somebody here. So we kind of just, you know, plugged and played as the company grew, which at times is a little slower growth trajectory, and it taxes your workforce more, including yourself, but it's a little bit more conservative. You're not taking as much risk with that payroll and that heavy comp that, that kills companies. Today, I think we've transitioned a little bit where we added 500 people during COVID. We were booming. We were lending. Wow. So nobody else was lending, and we were lending. And so what happened was our volume skyrocketed, our opportunities skyrocketed. We believed in a fix with the big governments in the world. We believed the United States government, you know, you take Russia, China, you take Europe, they were going to solve this thing. They were going to come up with vaccines. They weren't going to let the world just go to waste. So I made that call and I said, we're going to lend, you know, and the U.S. government was big. I mean, they came out with PPP. They came out with a loan deferral. And yep. So they helped us get through as a lender, and they helped business owners get through by giving them deferral of 90 days, 180 days, and not calling it past due, by getting them that PPP money. And so we made a little bet that it would be okay, that you had big powers doing stuff to fix that. So we lent because volume was so good, because the demand was so high, we needed more people.
Right.
So we hired aggressively. And what we were able to really do, Judge, is we were able to really steal a lot of good people from big competitors, like smart people that were saying, hey, my company's not lending. We're in the lending business. Everybody's scared to death. In fact, we're doing kind of small layoffs. Mm-hmm. I want to get out of here.
So on that particular note on hiring and really surrounding yourself with the top performers, especially during the pandemic, tell me a little bit about some of the strategies that really helped you in terms of talent acquisition and really attract the top talent during that time. What did you guys do? What really helped you succeed in that space during that time?
The biggest thing, it's a great question because it was a game changer. You'd be surprised how many people you can't come and get to endure Syracuse winners and who don't think Syracuse is a destination location. I'll give them, it's not 9 months out of the year, but 3 months out of the year, June, July, and August, it's beautiful. And you'd be a little surprised how many people don't want to go to Fort Lauderdale. And we had about a 40-person office in Manhattan on Lex and 40th. And again, you get more people that want to go there, but us attracting top talent from, let's say, other fintechs out of San Francisco to move to Syracuse and move to Florida was difficult. It was challenging. To get people to come out of LA, to get people to come out of Austin, Chicago, was difficult. COVID changed it. We went remote. We went remote March 15th, a year and a half ago. We were remote with 100 employees, well, 5 years before that. So we were very good at being remote. We're 100% digital with our business. So the demand was huge. We don't have a lobby and we're a lender. So to be able to come into us digitally has always been a nice option. During COVID, it became a go-to. So it was a home run. And being able to talk to somebody in San Francisco and say, we're fine with you working right out of your apartment, your house, your family. If you'd like to move east, we'd be happy to have you. But if you want to move to Salt Lake City, if you want to move to Montana, we don't care. So the ability, because of COVID, to hire that remote worker who didn't have the expense of moving, who had his family and friends, or she had her family and friends right there, no problem. You can work for us full time. We're going to Zoom it anyway, and we'd love to have you on board. So, you know, I don't think we followed Google, but we were right next to Google with our $1,000 allowance. You know, we have full time gym one on one coaches. We have gyms in every location. You couldn't do that at COVID. We have coffee machines. We have bistros. You couldn't do that in COVID. So what we said is, hey, if you really like the coffee machines, with your $1,000 budget, go buy yourself a $250, you know, high-tech coffee machine. Yeah, if you really like working out, go get yourself a home gym. We don't care what you do with the $1,000. We'd like you to keep it business-oriented, where if it was in the office, you could buy it at home. And so we have 40 hours of work of free psychiatry.
Nice.
So we're using out because again, we were getting away from the one-on-one, and I said, what do our employees need? Our employees need, they need some medical, they need some mental release.
Mental, that's huge. I love that. And you don't see that a lot. It's such a overlooked component of the mental aspect of this, which, you know, I spend a lot of time talking to executives at different companies. And one topic that also comes up a lot is how do you prepare your organization for the next period? What's coming next, coming out of pandemic? Hybrid model, we're trying to bring employees back to physical locations. What's your strategy there? What are you doing about, you know, are you keeping everything virtual?
We're doing a hybrid. So I'm back. I'm in the office right now because I don't know if you're probably too young. If you remember The Shining with Jack Nicholson, when he was up in that hotel and they do it for a winter. And he walks to, his wife walks into his computer and says, Jack is going stir crazy. Jack, and it's just line after line after line. I said to my wife, I said, I'm feeling a little bit like Jack Nicholson and Shiny. I got to get back into the office because, you know, the gal who cleans my house, super gal, but she and I have gotten to know each other on a one-on-one basis, having coffee in the morning. And I got to get out of here. And so I came back and I love change. So when we went into COVID, besides the stress of going into COVID, I enjoyed being home because I travel every week. Yep. So it was different. I was like, wow, I get to be around the family, I get to be around my wife. Everything was really cool. But after a while, I love collisions. So if you were working here, John, I would love to collide with you. Just randomly. Hey, you're in the bistro, I'm in the bistro, grab a coffee. Hey, you know, what'd you guys do last night? How was the weekend? Were you out on the lake? You know, and what I found with COVID is you get no collisions. Everything's pre-planned. If I'm not Zooming you, I'm not running into you. And so I Zoom with probably my top 25 chiefs, and which is a big chiefs group. You know, a lot of people are 6, 8, but I've got 25. Beyond that, I saw nobody. I had no communications besides the monthly award. So we took one office in Syracuse. It's our financial headquarters, 22,000 square feet. And we had 60,000 square feet in Syracuse pre-COVID. We had another 60,000 in Florida. And so I said, hey, everybody come back. 3% wanted to come back when we did a survey. 3.
Right.
So I'm in here with maybe 5 other people. And so I said, okay, let's do this. Let's take all of the different departments and let's just, I don't care if you're marketing, compliance, analytics, sales, come to 201 Solar, which is where my office is. I said, let's just fill this. So we did that. And today the office is probably 90% filled. And so it is a, and what I like is it's the vibe. Mm-hmm. I walk in, it's a very modern building. It's open, a lot of windows, and it's a buzz. You know, you can feel the energy. I can't feel the energy in my home office. No. So anybody who wanted to go back, I said, first in gets it. And it wasn't even a rush to the door. It wasn't like, oh, I want to be first in so I can have an office up at 201, which is more of the corporate headquarters. It was a slow leak in.
Yeah.
So what we've said is, do you want to work at home? Work at home. You know, we have reporting that's crazy. You know, we have analytics that's pretty amazing to watch production. Production's never been at a higher point. People seem to love working at home. I think, again, John, from a recruiting standpoint, I think some of these big companies that are forcing their workers back have to be a little bit careful. They're going to lose them if they're looking at their friends and they're looking at their peers. Yeah. And, you know, BHG is saying, we don't care where you work. And yeah. Your company's saying, I need you in here 5 days a week in Wall Street.
That's funny because I hear that a lot. I hear that a lot from, you know, just the chatter from former coworkers or other, you know, companies that those that are forcing the employees to come back, I think they're very limited in the sense that other organizations that really offer that flexibility to be able to make your own decision, I think is going to end up winning in this particular market. So in terms of just your personal, you know, sources that you utilize on a daily basis to educate yourself, to stay ahead of the curve, share with us, what do you consume on a daily basis with so much information thrown at us? How selective are you? What really helps you stay informed?
I have, you know, internally, I have a bunch of reports that I get every morning and every night. And so that helps me stay very informed to and get a beat on the business. Externally, you know, at times, it's funny, during really harsh times, I don't watch the nightly news because it's too depressing and I don't think you can do anything about it. I told my staff, keep working. What they're going to report is, unfortunately, we're going to report deaths. We're going to report it's a bad situation. We're going to report negativity, and it's horrible. But you can't do anything about it. You're going to have to let these big governments get us out of this. We can't get us out of this as individuals. We don't have the ability to move the needle. Mm-hmm. So I try to go with a philosophy where let the big boys do their work, the big boys and the big girls. And they'll solve this. And while they're solving it, as long as we didn't give up who we are, sooner or later, when it's solved, we'll be in a great position because we didn't give up on who we were. Versus just saying, oh my God, I can't do anything. The whole thing's a disaster and I quit or else I just crawl into a hole. Right. So I don't love the news during crisis because I think it just accentuates the crisis. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, I like to watch the nightly news, get an idea of what's going on around the world, get a flair for what's going on. I read a lot. I'm a reader of Barron's. I really like Barron's. You know, I think it gives a good financial synopsis of the financial world on a weekly basis. I do read Barron's daily too. You know, on online. I follow CNBC. You know, they're one. I love ESPN. You know, a lot of times I'll be right. ESPN Sports Center on just to, because I want to just get away from everything else. So yeah,
and I think that's important.
And I think it's important too because you know you can watch the same stuff. And news, as you know, it comes at you so fast that you can get your feed of it nowadays very very quickly online. Right. So to wake up in the morning, I've got a 12-year-old son to sit there and watch ESPN Sports Center and do something maybe a little bit different, maybe not as intense as a lot of the rest of the things that you're looking at is something I enjoy too.
Right. No, that's super exciting. Definitely. Thanks for sharing that. Last but not least, in terms of books, you mentioned you also read a lot. Is there one that you always recommend to others? And why is that? Perhaps something that you share with the new hires or anything like that?
Sure. It's Five Dysfunctions of a Team. With Patrick Lencioni. I mean, I'm sure, you know, it's not that, you know, sophisticated or that, you know, big outlier secret book. I love
it's a classic.
It's a classic. You know, you got to build that triangle. And I say that all the time. You got to build that trust. You got to build that healthy conflict. You know, you have to go up that pyramid and get up to results. I love his book. You know, we learned a lot from one of his top guys, Pat Ritchie, way back in 2012, he came in, he made it organizationally healthy. So I like, you know, I like books. I love books where you, like I just read, I'm hating it, Eisner's book from Disney, you know, not very complicated, you know, but again, I love reading about other successful people and how they did it, how they manage people, because there's so many variations of how people work with other people. So that's enjoyment for me too.
I love that. Al, I can't thank you enough for your time today. Very short, high energy. I love the energy. With all of my guests, what I love doing is a follow-up episode in about a year to see how much I've changed, how much I've transpired, and revisit the conversation from a year ago and see if everything that we talked about still makes sense. So I definitely look forward to doing that with you as well.
Same here, John. Really appreciate the time with you today. Always a lot of fun. So thanks again for having me on.
Likewise. We'll talk soon. Thanks so much.
Thank you, John. Bye-bye.